than just sort of let everything go, I think we do need at times to make some tough decisions as to where those resources are going to be put to save at least the things that we think we can save, and to apply some science. You know, what do we think is most important? From a phylogenetic or an ecosystem function point of view, not every species is equal. We actually are going to need to make some actual decisions about where we put our eggs in that basket, because the default situation is that we'll just lose things because we haven't done anything. Some other issues I think we need to actively address is, okay, it's anathema to many conservationists to think about engineering the environment and creating habitat. But is it such a bad thing? Where we've lost environments or where we need new ones for species, let's think about creating them. This is the precursor to creating a new coral reef. These are seawalls keeping back the tide. This is not a very happy place for any organisms. Perhaps we can do better. Here's an artificial wetland being created. How much of this do we need to do to counteract some of the other forces prevailing for our biodiversity? We also need to consider climate change not being in isolation from everything else. We all know we've got an enormous land clearing problem in Australia. The Queensland has been really terrible. Luckily, the Queensland Parliament's just brought in some legislation to hopefully once again halt broad-scale land clearing. And I'm afraid, and I'll be a bit political here, New South Wales is about to embark on new legislation which is going to start broad-scale land clearing. That new vegetation legislation is a complete disaster, in my view. But all of these sorts of environmental stresses interact with each other, and in many cases synergise with each other. We need to look at barriers to adaptive movement. Some of our species are adapting on their own quite well, but there are lots and lots of barriers, be they things that we can't change. You know, if something gets to the top of a mountain, can't do much more with it. Waterways are barriers to movement, and if they run east-west along the coast, as most of ours along the east coast of Australia do, it's very difficult for freshwater species to get between them. Islands, of course, some of the things on islands like Lord Howe here simply cannot move anywhere else under their own steam. Of course, once something gets to a south coast, or if it's isolated in a little patch, this is the Forbes map sheet recently, all of these things provide or indicate barriers to adaptation. So what we need to be doing is reversing this inevitable cycle of fragmentation and loss of connectivity and turning it back in the other way. That won't save everything, but it can certainly help. We also need to identify places in the landscape that provide refuges for species as the climate continues to change, and they won't necessarily be the same places that have always provided those refuges. We need to identify some in the future. These pictures are just from one of my colleagues' work where they've been using geographic information systems and putting climate change scenarios on top of those systems to try to figure out where in the landscape will provide the most protection to the most species in the future, and then we need to make sure we protect those. We need to do an awful lot of, by turning back the clock on habitat fragmentation, I think we need to do an awful lot more of this. But we also need to do it in a different way to how we've done it previously. Most restoration projects that plant in species tend to look for species that have always grown in that area. In fact, many local councils insist that if you're going to source seeds or cuttings to be planted back into a landscape, those seeds or cuttings need to come from a local provenance, 5 or at the most 20 kilometres away from the planting site. This is actually, in my view, an extremely futile and short-term view, because if you're planting things back in that are locally adapted under one climate, they will not necessarily be adapted under a rapidly changing climate. And if any of you are interested in this particular area, some colleagues of mine and I have produced a guide for restoration. I can give you that later. for restoration in the future, taking climate change into consideration. Here's another thing that we need to actively address. What do we move? Do we move anything? Conservationists are very conservative people on the whole, and they don't like to think about moving anything, believe me. In fact, one of my most inspirational papers, which was published back in 1985, about the implications of climate change for landscapes and species, said back then, we are going to have to translocate lots of species to save them. I recently did a bit of a count of how many species globally have been moved in order to protect them in a climate-changed world. Would anybody like to guess how many species have been moved for that purpose?
Not enough.
Certainly not enough. Anybody like to just put a number on that?
10.
10? No, too many? More than, less than 10, more than zero?
2.
Yeah, 2. Exactly right. There have been 2 globally species moved. One back in about the mid-90s was an endangered conifer called Torreya taxifolium in the US. And one was in 2016, which was a trial, the Western Swamp Tortoise in Western Australia in here. 2 species in 35 years have been moved to save them from climate change. So I think we need to ask this question. Can we be a bit more relaxed about where species live as long as they live somewhere? We need to actually break out of this mindset, in my view, that everything has to live where we think they should live, which is where they were living when I was 6 years old. Here's another really ticklish conundrum. What about native species that are doing really well and moving into areas where they're not so popular? Tracy was telling me about the grey-headed flying foxes in Bathurst, for example. Here's a couple of examples. This is the long-spined sea urchin. It's a New South Wales coastal species, didn't do much harm there. It's now moved in that East Australian current down to Tasmania. It eats kelp, and this is what it does. It basically clears the kelp forest. It's basically destroyed the habitat of at least 150 other species. Now, it's a native species. It's not native to Tasmania, but it is native to Australia. What do you do about it? Here's something else. These are lianas in the Amazon rainforest, and they occur in Australia as well. Lianas are doing really well out of all the extra CO2 in the atmosphere. They're growing really quickly, and they're killing trees because they bring trees down underneath their weight. What do we do about that, if any? So the question of, this is how one of my colleagues put it. Do we shoot them or we give it a medal? There's no right answer to that question, but we do need to be aware that with all of these species, some of them being advantaged and some of them being disadvantaged and moving around the country, we can't ignore management decisions about them. Here's something else we're doing. As humans adapt to climate change, we're doing all sorts of things. We're putting in more dams, we're clearing more fire breaks for fire, we're building desalination plants. Yeah. All of these sorts of human adaptation measures and many others potentially have collateral damage for biodiversity. In fact, and biodiversity is often a very low priority when it comes to human adaptation to climate change. In fact, one of my colleagues, James Watson at the University of Queensland, has written a paper that says human adaptation to climate change is probably the single largest threat to biodiversity. It's a big claim, but even the way we mitigate climate change can have impacts on biodiversity. Storing carbon in fast-growing monocultures does a great job storing carbon, not much good for habitat, etc. I'll just plug, it's a bit fuzzy I'm afraid, but I'll plug a little paper that I and some colleagues have just had published called Renewal Ecology. We've coined this new term, and it's all about how do we adapt as a human species without screwing up all of the biodiversity around us. And we put forward a whole bunch of examples where you can actually do both at the same time, but it does take a bit more of that engineering changing approach. Here's just a few examples on the shorelines. Make them living shorelines instead of just building a seawall to keep the ocean back. Do them in such a way that actually supports other things. These are called living shorelines, where dunes have been built rather than a seawall and vegetated. Some more examples. Habitat in urban areas. We can adapt in urban areas with more street trees and artificial wetlands and things like that, which provide amenity for human populations, cool the microclimate as well, if it's done well, as well as provide habitat. More artificial wetlands. I'm very keen on building artificial wetlands. I think they can be fantastic if they're done well. Artificial reefs, just showed you some of those. One of my hats that I wear is as a director of WWF Australia, and we've been having active discussions now promoting an idea of building a new reef, the Great Southern Reef, to the south of our existing Great Barrier Reef in some way to hopefully provide habitat and refuge for species moving south and save a whole bunch of things from the impacts of leaching. Low flammability gardens, this is an idea. Low flammability fire breaks. Not all plants burn at the same rate. A couple of my colleagues, Ross Bradstock and David Bowman, who are fire ecologists, think that there is enormous possibilities of, instead of actually just bulldozing a fire break, actually planting things that are of low flammability that reduce risk of fire, but also still provide habitat. Anyway, that's the general idea of renewal ecology. Jess mentioned earlier that the NARCLIN website, and I just want to show you a few of the tools for planning produced by the state government and also by CSIRO for those of you actively interested, and I can give you these websites later. One of them that's really useful is the CSIRO BOM website called Climate Change in Australia, and there's lots of tools on that website. The one that I really like is the Climate Analog tool. And I'll show you a little one that I did for Bathurst in a moment. Basically, you can put in any town you like. You can choose a climate scenario. You can choose a temperature or a rainfall scenario for the future. You press a button, and in less than a second, it gives you... you choose an emission scenario, low, medium, or high, and then it gives you a whole bunch of towns by a certain date that now have the climate that you might expect, say, for Bathurst by that date. So, for example, I put in the other night when I was preparing this talk, Bathurst in 2030 under a medium emission scenario. The analog towns are these ones. So these are all the places that currently have a climate like we might expect Bathurst to have under that scenario in 2030. Mm-hmm. I can, if there's anybody interested in operating this tool, I can just show you on the computer after the talk. It's very easy to do, and it's a way of imagining the future. Because, for example, if you were a landscape planner and you wanted to go and say, okay, well, what sort of vegetation might I be wanting to revegetate around my town that will be sustainable still in 2030, well, actually going and looking at the native vegetation around one of these analogue towns can give you some ideas. We've mentioned the NARCLIN website, Adapt New South Wales. It has a wealth of information about climate change in New South Wales in the future. Lots and lots of maps, downscaled predictions for the future, such as the slide I showed you earlier on. Very, very valuable resource for planning. And then another thing that we've been, I've been involved in, this little website that we've been producing, funded by the state government, but with some colleagues at Macquarie, is called Weed Futures. It's a website where you can go and type in a place or a local land service or a national park or a species, search that for a particular weed, and it'll tell you what the future of that weed might be under a certain climate scenario in your part of the world. Once again, a tool for planning. Okay, some final thoughts. I hope I've convinced you that climate change is actually having serious impacts now. It's a now problem, it's not just a future problem, but the impacts will accelerate the further we go into this century. The climate that we will get in the next few decades is already set from the greenhouse gases that we've already emitted, because there's a lag time between when we put emissions into the air and when it has an impact on climate change. It's not a tap that you can simply turn off. You can just try to reduce it to a trickle. So we already pretty much know what the next few decades is going to be like. The point about that is what we do now in terms of our energy mix and all of those things that are having an impact on emissions, that will affect our climate in about the second half of this century. So when our children and our grandchildren are having to deal with the consequences. That's what I just said. Ecosystems are transforming. They're transforming at an enormous rate. They will continue to do so, and maintaining the status quo, conserving everything the way it is right now, isn't an option. So we need to think differently about climate change. We need to be very transparent about prioritising what our real conservation actions might be, and not, like we did with the Bramble Key Malomies, simply monitor everything until it doesn't exist anymore. And so in sum, I think we need, when I say new ways of thinking about conservation, they're not really new. I mentioned that paper written in 1985, which basically said all of this back then. Unfortunately, conservationists and land managers have been rather slow to take up those ideas, and we simply cannot afford to be slow any longer. And I can't go past giving the Climate Council a little bit of a plug. As Jess said, the last time I was in Bathurst was with the Climate Commission. That was a government-funded body tasked with bringing climate change communication to the Australian public. It lasted 2.5 years before we were abolished by the incoming Abbott government on their second day. It was actually their first act, was to abolish the Climate Commission. We knew our job was not finished, so we went out to the public to ask for funding. 4.5 years later, we are still going as the Climate Council. We've got now, I think, 23 staff and offices in Melbourne and Sydney, and have outlasted Tony Abbott as the Prime Minister. quite a long way, actually. I'm quite pleased about that. We've now published nearly 100 reports on lots and lots of different topics, including agriculture and energy and battery storage and all sorts of things. We have many videos. Everything is shareable. Everything is produced under Creative Commons. So you can share it as much as you like. In fact, we want you to do that. We have lots of social media followers. We potentially reach now $8 million per month on our media and Facebook, etc., etc. And as was also mentioned before, we have started this thing called the Cities Power Partnership. I'm very pleased to say that Bathurst has recently joined up to that. And that is about supporting local governments on the ground, starting to make pledges for sustainable transport, community engagement, renewable energy, etc., etc. We thought we would only get 15 councils to start with when we started this program last year. We had 35 in the first round, another 35 have just joined, so we now have 70. We probably have about 100 by the middle of the year. And then, of course, we need more staff to keep supporting it. But it's proved to be a really, really attractive thing for local councils to be supported in the journey that we all have to make. And I think this is all. I want to leave you with my favourite placard from the People's Climate Marches before the Climate Summit in Paris, because for me it sums up where we're at. You know, it's not just up to the politicians, it's not just up to the scientists or the local government councillors or whatever. This to me sums up the fact that it's actually up to all of us. And I'll stop there. Thank you very much.